this is my first event, and I had to pound on the doors to get them to let me in. They're like, who are you? But when I went to the website, you know, the thing that caught me was the word storytelling. Over and over and over, I think it's up there like 113 times, the word storytelling. And then I'm looking through it, and it's like, okay, there's LARP, there's ARG, whatever that is. You know, there's all these different acronyms and all these different things, transmedia. I don't see traditional storytelling. Where's old school? Where's the 40,000 years of traditional storytelling represented here? And so, you know, I kept knocking on the door, and finally they said, yeah, okay. And I was kind of, you know, hesitant because, you know, as a storyteller, I'm looking to get a gig, not just come as a patron. And, you know, hopefully I'm hoping they feel like they got their money's worth. But so I sent him a contract, and he signed it and sent it back. And so here I am. I'm wandering around, and this has a vibe unlike any other event I've been to. The thing is when you travel the continuum of geekdom, right? Every geek you know has 20 overlapping. You know, we are the Venn diagram from hell. For instance, your SCA fighter may be also a Civil War person who may also be into pyrotechnics, who may also be into leatherworking, who also may be, you know, a game designer who may also, and so they all overlap. And so when you get to Wyrd Con, you're looking around and you see all these people from all these different walks of life who all have common interests. Some of them is chasing each other with foam swords. Some of it may be, you know, playing tabletop. Some of it may be designing games. Some of it may be what have you. But the cool thing is that all of these people overlap and they all have this amazing creative energy. And so last night when I got a chance to actually do a traditional story in a room, you know, with, you know, brought kind of more modern, made it relevant. I didn't do it in old Gaelic, for instance. You know, Shelley Curionis Coyagrave, Ictor, you know, what? But, and the audience went, ah, we got it. We're there for you. And so when I got a chance to do that, I was like, okay, these are my peeps. This is, you know, this is a place I need to be. Because I am the high priest of promoting storytelling in the modern age. Unfortunately, in the storytelling community, traditional storytelling isn't as big as it used to be. And it wasn't like storytelling was, you know, on fire all that much to begin with. If you say you're a storyteller in modern day life, people say, oh, you read books to kids. And that's sad, really. And so I get here and Ira showed me around his labyrinth. Oh my God. I mean, this is innovation. This is a place where magic is happening. And you can say, oh, look, it's a bunch of kids chasing themselves around with foam swords. Yeah. The geeks did inherit the earth. The crowned heads of Hollywood go to San Diego Comic-Con to bow down to us. You know, if you think about it that way. If you look at 30%, 40% of all media, fantasy, folklore, science fiction. Where would Hollywood be without vampires and werewolves? You know, Star Trek, Star Wars, superheroes. Look at the Avengers, for instance. Okay? Well, we've got a wizard with magical armor. A wizard possessed by a powerful demon. A soldier who drank a potion that gives him super strength, and he has a magic shield. Let's see, who else do we have? We have, of course, a Norse god. Never hurts to have one of those.
Right. We've got an archer with magical arrows, and we've got a redhead. Which is, you know, pretty much the standard storyteller six pack. I mean, that's what it is. That's storytelling. These are characters. same thing. It's just they changed their tights. Seriously. And so, the cool thing is, even though Hollywood runs to the well of inspiration and brings heavily from it and splashes around the pool and occasionally pees in it, right? The well of inspiration, right? For 40, 80,000 years, human tradition has been going into great space, the inspirational space. We wouldn't be in that space if it weren't for this space. Albert Einstein said that imagination is more important than knowledge. Absolutely. You have to be able to conceive it before you can build it. And if you think about all the great minds that have passed on stories all around us, these kids chasing each other with foam swords in their other lives, they are computer programmers. They may be writing the next great novel. They may be doing whatever they're doing, but the thing is they get it. They are looking at what resonates, what is relevant to them. And the key to storytelling, the most important thing in storytelling is knowing how to speak the truth, how to make it relevant. And there are a lot of different hobbies out there, and they're all wonderful. You know, everybody has their hobbies and what makes them sing, right? The cool thing about storytelling is we don't have any limits. That's the thing that frightens people. When they see us in the elevators dressed with purple hair, right? When they see us chasing each other with foam swords or getting upset about something that we just imagined. Yeah, they look a little weird, but we're willing to go places and come back with things that could make a difference to the human condition. If you want to get somebody to understand you, you tell them a story. If you want to tell a story, right, the first thing you need to do is check in with that other person's material. You know, to give you an example, polygenesis, the concept of Cinderella, the traditional story of Cinderella. There are 100 versions of Cinderella, and they sprang up spontaneously. And so you have Turkey Girl,
the Navajo tradition.
You have Caparushas up in Scotland. You have versions of Cinderella all over the world. Why did humanity create this? What do we learn? Right? Now, in the Navajo tradition, it's the fairy godmother. So to speak, right? But Disney goes and takes these myths, right? The Little Mermaid, which, by the way, the original story did not end so well. Prince Charming, so on and so forth. All these things, and they regurgitize it and sanitize it, and they polish it, and they get it out there. And on the one hand, I'm kind of like, please tear down their original speaker. Because the original stories were much scarier and more powerful. Back then, kids saw animals being slaughtered all the time. They saw what it was to live in the real world. Food didn't come in plastic packages. And so, in the Grimm's fairy tale, right, when the evil stepmother was forced to put on iron, red hot iron shoes and dance away, to their mind, right? Because this was not something that was out of the realm of their imagination. Now we've sanitized it, right? Our death is pushed away from us. And sometimes by taking what we do and polishing it and making it all pretty and safe, we do ourselves a disservice. And so bringing that back to where we are here, we're now pushing back out those envelopes. We're going into the dark territory. We're going into the imagination. We're going into places where how you look at the universe has a great deal about who you are as a person. That's a powerful thing. So the long, 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 long answer to Wyrd Con is, it's an amazing place. There's really some cool energy happening here. I don't know it really well, but it's my hope that Wyrd Con will look for the future for its storytelling energy, that it will embrace it and acknowledge who and what they are, which is a little miniature cauldron of inspiration. about how cool it is to PvP. It's a key challenge here, right? Our generation of geeks, we look past things like gender. I mean, yeah, we've got all the standard foibles of modern-day people, modern-day Americans, you know, sexist, racist, whatever. But in this community, there.